Hello and welcome to Around the Wickets. We are on ThePapare.com. It's lovely to be back with you once again to talk about some cricket and talk about the future and where Sri Lanka will be heading in the field of cricket. So let's start off with the T20 series that is happening in Australia that is about to happen. And before I go anywhere, we would normally have Fawiz Maaruf, who used to be our faithful guest. But this week and for a few weeks ahead, we might have to release him because he's got other important duties. But instead, I think we've got a perfect substitute. The only difference is, when I say perfect substitute, perfect in a few ways, but not exactly the carbon copy because he's a batsman. He wouldn't bowl. He would come on and bowl some off spin. But Maaruf was different. Yeah. Anyway, good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome, Jehan.
Thank you. Thanks, Roshan.
Right. Good to have you with us. And let's start off with your thoughts on the Sri Lanka tour. I mean, we've discussed this squad, but three T20s. And how do you see, how excited are you to see these young cricketers in the side and putting their hands up and being countered and defeating the top ranked T20 team in the world?
Yeah, it's great for them, and going from Pakistan to Australia, both away series, to see whether they can, and it will be, although Pakistan were the number one ranked team in the world in T20 cricket, I still feel Australia away is a step up from that, and how we cope to the conditions and to the opposition. It's exciting, a lot of young players in there. I hope they get the same game time that they did in Pakistan with the new, with the senior players coming back. If the side gets shuffled around again, whatever we've built we'll need to go through another rebuilding phase. I think we've established something.
Just to stop you there, now we've got who? We've got Kusal Pereira in the side, we've got Kusal Mendis in the side, the Kwala is in the side, Lasith Mahalinga is non-negotiable, he's the captain. So, what are you saying? If you are a selector, how would you juggle around with these guys? I mean, I can understand who should the Fernando be left out with his one game. But tell me about the others.
I mean, I would definitely have Dasun and Bhanuka in that in the playing
11. So, tell me your six. Top six.
Top six?
Yes. Or we can go down, we can take the 11.
One guy I would consider leaving out of the playing 11 is Kusal Mendis.
That's because of his injury.
Because of his injuries, and because we have good players available to step up there. So Kusal Pereira coming in, no problem.
So you would open with
Kusal and maybe Danushka.
So Avishka, you would.
Avishka may be at number 3.
Okay. So what happens to Bhanuka then? He's at number 3.
Bhanuka can either go down to number 4 or Avishka comes in.
Isn't it unfair by Bhanuka? I mean, if you're looking to push him down to number 4, someone who's gone in and played two outstanding innings. I mean, I saw it. I was there, the way he took on the spinners and the fast bowlers. So I feel it's unfair.
Yeah.
I mean,
you that's fine. That's okay. He can bat at 3, 4. It doesn't really matter where they bat. So 1, 2, 3, 4.
Right.
And then...
So you bat who? Who would be you bat at 4? You have Kusal and...
So Kusal Mendis would probably have played
so at 4 or 5.
Avishka bats at 4. Mm. And then Shehan Jayasurya.
Do you really play Shehan Jayasurya?
If
you know
Kusal Mendis,
you know why I ask you that question? Because I thought he played outstandingly. That 96 he got was magnificent. The batting in that T20 game was just fantastic. But for some reason, I felt he was struggling on the field.
Maybe, but because he offers the off-spin option with the ball, which we can...
No, I don't know whether he's carrying an injury. Or some Maybe. Sort of an issue, because he wasn't as agile and quick as the rest of the boys.
Yeah.
That was
Maybe.
Quite apparent.
Yeah. But so again, so maybe he can, if that's an injury issue, then that's fine. It's based on injury. Otherwise, Oshada, Shehan Jayasurya, Dasun Shanaka, and then you have your all-rounders.
So where would Dikwela come in?
Dikwela will come in the middle to me.
Where?
At the moment.
What's the point in paying Dikwela down the order? Someone in a T20 game?
As the wicket keeper. Others, you need to get Kusal Pereira to
very
keep.
Very combative kind of batsman who would go after the bowling, who would who would score runs quickly.
They all are. In T20 cricket, everybody, the only guy who can hold the innings, who will hold the innings together, is probably Oshada, who can knock it around, and they can build the innings around him. So Kusal Mendis would be the other person who would do
we
that.
We need about 13 in the team to play there.
No, so 11. So I would.
No, I know it's a good headache.
It's a
positive headache to have. I mean, I'm just picking his brain. Yeah. It's not easy. And I think you're thankful that you're not selected at this moment. Anyway, that's how it looks with the Australian series. But, you know, I want to take you to a very interesting development that has happened in the recent past about the player contracts. Now, SLC appears to have done away with their tried and tested method, if that's the right word, for about 5 to 6 to 10 years of contracting almost 100 players, and they have now pruned it down to 34, and they are at the highest level. Whilst they have done away with the emerging contract, I think they've done away with provincial contracts, and there are some major discards. Upul Taranga, Asela Gunaratna. I can understand Asela Gunaratna. He's been injured, so maybe he needs to come back. I don't know. Shehan Madushankar, Malinda Pushpa Kumara is gone. Banuka Rajapaksa, that's a bit of a surprise for me, but could be that this was decided before Banuka's efforts in Pakistan. Pathum Nisanka, Kamidu Mendis. I think that's a guy that Sri Lanka should be investing a lot and Ashan Priyanjan. Some of the names that are prominently figured in terms of missing out on the contracts. What are your thoughts as a ex-player and now coach, maybe future administrator, how it looks like, you know, the club contracts or the provincial contracts, 104 gone. So now the structure is, and I've also been told that the clubs are going to be given a little bit more beef in their finances to contract some of their key players. So how do you see this scenario?
So overall, my first question would
my question is too long.
That's fine. My answer will be shorter. Overall, my question is, the money that was spent on player contracts last year, is the same amount of money being given to the players this year as well?
Right. You mean the 34 or
no,
the entirety?
The entirety. Okay. Either through the clubs or directly through SLC, how much money is being invested in player contracts and player fees, match fees. If that amount is the same, I'm okay with it. It should either be the same or more. I am doubtful that it is the same. I feel it is less and a lot less. Because even though there are 34 contracted, the amounts are, you get like four or five in the top bracket. And most of them are in the lower brackets.
Right. So you mean to say let's look at the player contracts of 34. Now, we have the Matthews, the Karunaratnas, Lakmal, Chandimal, Lasith Malinga in category A. Then if you look at the last category, Premier category, there are 11 players. Category D, there are 10. So are you trying to say that those guys are really low?
See, even within the categories, there are gradings.
Okay.
So a category would have $40,000, $30,000, $20,000. So even within the category, there are gradings. So overall, if you just calculate and arrive at a figure, you might get, I'm not sure why I haven't done that calculation, but compared to last year, and then if they are going to give money to the clubs, is the board in a position to ensure that the clubs do contract players?
I think that's the key. That has to be the key. Because, you know, you can't be giving handouts to clubs and say, look, this is the money you need to pay your players. I think what the board needs to do, and I believe, I've heard from the grapevine, that they're going to specify that this amount goes for contracts. And I also heard that the player fees have increased, which is good. Still not enough. But I'm at least happy that there is a step in the right direction.
So if the player fees have increased, and I also think a club should contract a player for more than one season.
Absolutely.
To prevent players just switching clubs at the end of every season.
And Jehan, do you realize, sorry, we are digressing a little bit, we're moving away from the contracts into another scenario. Have you realized that in our local first class structure, if a club gets demoted, it's the club that gets demoted, not the player.
Not the player.
So the players have the option of floating around, which I think is a very unfair situation.
So I think a contract should be drafted where a player should be, at least for two seasons, should be a contract. And he should be paid enough to remain in that club.
What is enough, Jehan? What do you mean
What is a decent contract? Now, don't say £50,000. It's not going to work here. But from a Sri Lankan point of view, what are you thinking? What do you think is the
I'm
right
just
amount?
Thinking anyone who does a professional job should get paid in excess of ₹1 million a year. Your annual earnings from cricket should
that,
be...
That you mean with the contract and the player fees both?
With the contract and the player fees, if you're playing only domestic cricket.
All right. Yeah, I'm talking about a domestic.
Domestic. Player. A domestic player, that is enough where you get a monthly salary of ₹70,000 a month, which should be, I mean, that's enough for your... it should be in excess of that. Otherwise, it's really difficult to keep the players interested in the game. They'll be working part-time jobs here and there, going to Australia, going to England. So that is the kind of a figure that we should look at.
Right. It's an interesting topic, but I know that we're not going to have too much of time to dwell on it. But I also want to just let you know that the T10 League is happening again in Dubai. And the good news is, we've got a few Sri Lankans who've already got in there. Thisara Pereira, Lasith Malinga, Dasun Shanaka, Vanidu Hasaranga, Niroshan Dikwella, Banuka Rajapaksa. He should be a real hot property now going forward in T20 cricket. And, Kusal Pereira. Right, let's move away from all these leagues and all that and let's get to some proper cricket. The Under-19 tour of Bangladesh is happening. Now, Royal College coach Jehan Mubarak, put on that hat and tell us how is his Under-19 side looking.
Looks very good. They're missing two of their key players. But even without that, this Under-19 team over the last 6 months, even over the last year, have looked very good. Especially on the field. And fielding has been, in the past, fielding has been Sri Lanka's strength. But it hasn't been in the national team last 4 or 5 years. Our fielding has dropped off. But the Under-19 team are very, very good on the field.
Yeah, and also I think it was a good thing that they brought them into the mercantile tournament.
Yes, playing the mercantile tournament. A lot of them are playing premier cricket at SSC, NCC, at the major clubs.
I was going to ask you whether there are only two major clubs in the country and suddenly you remembered another one. That's fine. I'll forgive you. Right. I also want to ask you about this guy, Matisha Patirana. Have you seen him?
I have heard of him. I have not seen him, but...
Right. But they speak. I saw a little clip of him bowling to, I think, in a school game where he yorks a batsman.
Yes.
But it's a kind of a very low action.
He is very similar to what Lasith was like when he first came on.
Okay.
Thin, skinny guy.
What was the delivery, the point of delivery?
Similar.
The almost
same? Similar. But it's difficult to see, I mean, pace-wise and swing-wise without seeing him live. But it's a very unique action.
You know, now Sri Lanka has done the right thing by going to Bangladesh. I believe there is a West Indies. So there's so much of preparation going in. So how do you see the chances of the Sri Lankan side doing
good.
Well in the Under-19?
I think it's very good. And the preparation, compared to the national team, the Under-19 preparation is very, very much...
Where would you credit it?
To the plan. I mean, obviously, Roshan has...
Yeah, that's the question I want to ask.
Yeah.
They've got Roshan. There's Upul Chandana there, Sachit Patirana has come in. So quite a few new guys. And has Roshan really been that change?
It seems to. I mean, I haven't seen the practice session, but speaking to the boys from the squads, they know what they're doing. They look very professional. Even when they come to school practice sessions, they go about their business. They say, okay, I want to take catches. I want to do my slip fielding. I want to do my throwdowns. And it's a very professional mindset that they have got. But also the continuity. Over the last year, it's the same guys who have been playing. Few guys in and out, but the core group has remained the same. And that's, I think, something that the national team has not been able to do.
Right. So it's on that note that we are planning to end Around the Wickets on ThePapare.com. I'm so happy that Jehan sees so much of positives in the Under-19 side, because that's an area that Sri Lanka has been lacking. As he said, we've been quite boastful about our fielding some time ago. And do you know that in the 70s, early 80s, everyone, you know, like thought that the Sri Lankan Under-19 side was the best in the world. They would beat any your youth team, but unfortunately they have fallen away. But let's hope they'll come back with this World Cup tournament happening. Right, as I said, we're almost at the end of the show. I need to ask you the usual question. Now, this week I'm going to ask you the question about Sri Lanka versus Australia. My question is, name the player who scored the most runs for Sri Lanka in their first T20 encounter versus Australia. Now, we are having a T20 series. So I think it's a very appropriate question that we're asking you. Now, in case you want to figure out a little bit more, find out a few things about all these things, we just want to remind you that you need to subscribe to thepapare.com, because there is so much of information, content, and the latest that's happening from around the world of cricket. Now, last week our question was, it was a simple question, but well done, we've got a winner. What are the two countries that were reinstated as ICC members at the ICC board meeting held in Dubai? And the answer, Nepal and Zimbabwe. And the winner, we got a winner from Muscat in Oman. Thank you for watching us. That's wonderful. We know that this program goes around the world, but that's one thing. But to have a winner from somewhere outside Sri Lanka is another thing. W. Jerry from Muscat, Oman. Many congratulations on your win. So that's it on Around the Wickets on thepapare.com. Thank you for joining us. It was a privilege to bring this show to you. We'll join you again next week. Until then, it's goodbye from me and Jehan Mubarak.
Subscribe to our YouTube channel for more videos like this. And don't forget to hit the bell icon for our latest content.